create a safer environment. My rule, being very blunt, my rule on our campus is calm the campus down. You want a calm campus at all times. And if you have someone posting stuff offline because they stepped 1 foot off the property and are on their iPhone saying, I'm gonna do X, Y, and Z to you, you as a, your principal should have the authority to do something about it. This cyberbullying allows you as the district to create policies, to create procedures, and it empowers your principals to take action if you as a board want to let them take action. I am confident your attorney has a zillion things going through his head right now of all the problems. I mean, just because there is logistical issues. But the state wanted to give you covering because Miami-Dade had a very good policy. And what we're saying is this issue is kind of mushroomed over the last few years, and that we need a statewide policy and the districts need to be empowered to handle that issue. Any questions on that issue? Guess not. The next issue, which is kind of a big issue, and I'll tell you, I scaled it back and working with Senator Brandis, and he did a great job. It's called the MOOC bill, Massive Online Courses. What we're looking at is, when it started off, it was a really big bill that I couldn't support, but at the end, what he did with the bill and what was done with the bill, I would almost say this: if you don't support that kind of bill, you're doing it to your own detriment. I am not a fan of virtual education, straight up virtual education. I've never been shy about saying it. I think straight up virtual education has a lot of bad actors, has a lot of skeptical players, and it's, I call it unregulated wild, wild west education, if it's not done correctly. What the MOOC bill does, it's called the MOOC bill, is it creates some studies, it limits online education, it runs it through the Department of Education. It creates some parameters. It puts it in 5 courses. It links it to end of course exams. And what it begins to do, I think in Florida, is begins to structure our virtual education system going forward. It kicks everything out for 2 years and basically does a couple studies over the next couple years and says, as a state, what is our statewide policy dealing with online education and how we're going to implement it. It's coming. We see it. We're dealing with it. But if we don't have a proper handle on it, you're going to have lots of bad actors, and I think the quality of education will suffer. I'm a huge fan of blended online. There's a difference. You know, online straight up, they've never seen one. Blended, where it's online plus an instructor coming in, seeing people, touching, seeing, knowing what's going on. That, I believe, is the model you go to. What the MOOC bill does is it begins to put, I think, some bookends on online education and move that forward. It kicks everything out for 2 years out in the future and then begins to structure it. It is a pretty comprehensive planning process, but it doesn't authorize particular online issues this year like the original bill did. The original bill absolutely was a wide open bill. This one limited quite a bit. Any questions on the MOOC?
Yes, John, I don't know if it's under the MOOC or in a different bill. Two things, one about the reduction in funding, and the other is about out-of-state virtual companies, providers coming in, and also how does this open up our Pasco eSchool and give us opportunity to do that seventh period class?
Great question. This bill doesn't address all those. That's one or two of those issues. You're referring to the 1.0 funding with the virtual, right, which was in the budget proviso language, the budget conforming bills, not necessarily his bill. As you know, there is some growing, and I'm one of them, some growing concern about a subsidized monopoly in Florida and online education, which is Florida Virtual. And there's many of us, me included, that feel that perhaps what we need to do is not subsidize and protect Florida Virtual anymore, allow it to compete at a level playing field with you, Pasco County, and others. That doesn't occur overnight. So the first step in doing that was to cap it at 1.0. Now, with that, you create some other problems. Like any any change in a system. I actually met with your staff today that there may be some mechanisms that we can work in and rule dealing with. If a student is there six periods out of a day, physically in a day, at a public school, we may be able to work on some rules that could assist with ensuring you get your full class size funding. And to help offset, I think, some unintended consequences. But at the end of the day, I think what you're seeing happen is you're seeing a backing off of the state of protecting Florida Virtual as a preferred status and making it compete with everyone at a level playing field. That's what you're seeing on that level. The next, you know, there's also several little bills in there, and I won't get into those. Senator Monford led the way, and I kind of joke with him on this one. Instructional materials, about giving you the flexibility that you wanted with flexibility. As you know, Senator Monford is a former superintendent, head of the Superintendents Association. And when we were sat in a room and talked to Senator Monford, is this something you want to handle? Oh, absolutely, I want to do this. We're going to give flexibility. About 3 months later, he walks in and goes, John, perhaps I shouldn't have asked for what we wanted, because once you get what you want, all of a sudden all the districts start fighting. The smaller districts don't want flexibility. The bigger districts do. And so you had this internal war within your own association, school districts, of what type of flexibility do you want? Smaller districts didn't want the flexibility. They liked the current status. Larger districts wanted more flexibility. So he made a compromise bill that assisted the small districts, allowed them to collaborate and keep the current status, but it allowed larger districts the ability to have more flexibility if they like. So that was the instructional material bill. It's like everything. It's like the dog that caught the car sometimes. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden someone shoves it in reverse and runs you over. So the next bill dealing with is obviously you have the budget issue. The next one is dealing with all sorts of issues dealing with charter schools, dealing with teacher evaluations and the park assessments, which I'll spend a minute or two talking about.
Which one is that? 1630
was the Senate bill. 7009 is the House bill. That's a small bill that grew throughout the process. The original bill, and I'll start with the original bill, what the original bill addressed a real concern of mine dealing with online assessments, the park assessments, and are we ready? Are we as a state ready to do these assessments? And as we began looking around the state next year on these assessments for Common Core, Next Generation Standards, however you want to call it, what we saw is that we were not ready. The state of Florida is not ready for the online assessments. If you do low testing, I don't think there's a single district that met all the categories. Some districts met about 80% of the categories. About half the districts didn't even show up on the radar. If we were to throw this switch next year and say, we're gonna go online, do our online assessments next year, I think the whole system would have imploded on itself. So what we tried to figure out is, instead of saying, okay, we're just gonna kick it out 2 years and give ourselves 2 years more to do it, I don't think that was the right way to do it. What we felt, or I felt the best way to do it, was let's link it to the technology. We cannot implement the online assessments until our schools are ready. That's what that bullet bill says. Your infrastructure as a district have to be ready in order to do the online assessments. I believe that's the direction we need to go. I believe we need to do the online assessments, but we can't require it until you're ready. What this bill does is says those assessments are not going to be required until the technology is in the school systems to do it. The legislature as a whole, I'm kind of wrapping up and previewing, we spent significant dollars on technology this year. But I think that's the tip of the iceberg of what's coming in the next few years. That is where all the extra dollars that I see the state having going forward in the future is going to be going into the technology for our schools and to upgrade the hardwiring of the structure of our schools. I'm not a fan of giving every kid an iPad and say, here's your iPad, now go do whatever you want. Because guess what's going to happen to that iPad? It's going to sit in their locker. that's going to sit in their locker and it's not going to be utilized to the fullest ability. What I am a fan of is ensuring that all our schools have the infrastructure, the wireless broadband that they need, which our rural districts do not have, by the way, that we have the training for our teachers to implement this new level, which quite frankly, they're not up to speed on yet. And then the last piece of the puzzle is the devices. Everyone will have a better mousetrap for these devices, whether it's Apple, Samsung, Galaxy, you name it, you name the year, someone's gonna come in with it. The devices are the least of our concern. The most significant part of our concern is the infrastructure. And that's what we're focusing on this year, and I believe next year, is the infrastructure. And in hopefully year three, the devices would be the final level. The goal is 1-to-1. You know, that's an audacious goal, but the goal would be 1-to-1, whether it's a tablet form or some form to do these assessments. We will get there, and it's just gonna take a little bit of time. That was the core of that bill. The other parts of the bill dealt with charter schools, which originally I wasn't dealing with, but at the end, as you know, with North Star in Orlando, there was a really bad actor in the Orlando area. Senator Stargell's bill, quite frankly, wasn't going to make it across the finish line. So we took the most important components of her bill, dealing with accountability, dealing with transparency, dealing with audits, all those issues, and added it to this bill to ensure that you as the districts, that you have an understanding and you have authority when it comes to these bad actors in the charter school industry. One of the key provisions that, quite frankly, your superintendent, you know, worked with me on several other things, is dealing with reporting requirements. You know, if you, whether it's our friends in the media or as you school board members, if you really wanted to know what was in our monthly reports, what would you do? You would ask, you know, your local person to give you the monthly reports that charter schools produce. They would give it to you here in Pasco County. You would have a 75-page report written in terms code. And quite frankly, it wouldn't be much good to you as an individual board member. So what we required is that we have a uniform monthly reporting that's 2 pages long, that has line item by line item, profit and loss, how much is going to instructional, how much is going to administration, that you as a board member can look at and you can compare to other schools throughout the state. So you can compare this and you can post it online, that the schools are required to put it online. So individuals in the media can see how much are they spending, how much are they actually spending, and where is it going to. What it also says is when a school is in a financial state of emergency and begins to close down, any expenditure that's over $10,000, you as a school board have to approve. So you won't have these large payouts of $500,000, $300,000 payouts like what happened in Orlando. It provides more authority for you as an individual board member to begin to see that when you have problematic schools. Any questions on that charter provision?
Not the charter provision.
Maybe do the charter provision then go back. Ryan, you have a question?
Not on that. I wanted to address the policy issue that some people are confused about.
Sure, policy. There was a provision that was asked by many school districts and charter schools dealing with policies. What you begin to see throughout the state is you have multiple charter schools and multiple districts. And I'll use the cyberbullying as the best example. Some districts, and I'm not saying Pasco necessarily, but I know you're wrestling with this, so I don't want to imply you got your policies are bad. Cyberbullying policy, that's a tough policy. I mean, you know, where are you on this? Some districts are really far ahead, some are not so far ahead. Miami-Dade has always kind of been the leader on that particular policy. So if you had a school district that would have a policy that was probably less than a charter school on cyberbullying policy, which policy prevailed? The school districts or the charter schools? You began to open up stuff for lawsuits. The issue of pass-through policies, so whenever you had a policy, did it automatically apply to the charter school? Were they aware of it? Did they have to abide by it? How did they know about it? The policy pass-through provision on this basically said is that the charter school had to be aware of it. They had to sign off on it. They had to be understanding of it. And you as a board had to understand what their policy was. So you have to understand, does it prevent you from doing policies? It's just your policy does not apply to the charter school until they're aware of it and they sign off on it. and they have a chance to come to you and say, here's what our existing policy says. Because if you are in another county, and for example, like there's some management companies that have multiple charter schools, if you're in multiple districts, what if they had a superior policy dealing with an issue than the existing district? Which one took precedent? You know, and you start have all sorts of lawsuits opening there. So the one issue that I want to give your superintendent lots of shout outs for, and I think it's one of the hidden gems of session that has not been talked about in the press, but really your superintendent banged on me the day he got elected and said this, because he knows I'm a charter school fan. I can't do his accent, but he basically said, hey, charter schools have all these flexibilities issues. If we had them, watch what we could do. And you know what? He's absolutely right. So what we did is we created a district school of innovations. And if you take a look on the back page, Senator Montford and I worked hard on this to create a door. And I use the word a door. For basically you as a school district to create basically your own flexibility schools. It allows for flexibility at the class school-wide average level. Because if the governor signs this bill into law, all schools of choice will be at the school-wide average level. So if you have a school of choice, it's at the school-wide average. It's exempt from many of the existing statutes that similar to what charter schools are, that school of choice is. You demonstrate success 1 year in this one model, you're allowed to replicate it in your school district. The point is, as your superintendent requested, it's to maximize your flexibility, similar to charter schools, to take the best lessons of charter schools, which what was intended, and give those same tools to the school districts so they can replicate it. Now, Senator Montford had a bill that dealt solely with this. The House would not accept it. I've been around a little while, and I've learned how the art of negotiations. So we took his bill and put it on something that they had to have. And we changed it a little bit to make it germane. So we took that flexibility bill and called it a district technology school of innovation. Meaning that if you have a CAPE school, hint, 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 that say you got $1.5 million of funding for to retrofit a school, and you went in and you created a school of innovation that was at the school-wide average, that had tons of flexibility, that was subsidized by CAPE, that had startup money by CAPE programs, you in a sense could create a magnet school and give you and have significant flexibility in making sure that that school's a success here in the county.
Senator Legg, and the first one that we do, if we prove success with that, then we can replicate it. But
yes,
we only allow one the first go.
Round one, and then it's, forget the number, but you're allowed to mushroom up. You have to demonstrate success with one the first year, and once you have success, then you're allowed to keep replicating those. Yeah. Senator Mumford, that was the compromise to scale it back.
Success is in enrollment, or success is in
performance. Success is in performance.
In the first year.
The first year has to, before you can replicate. Before you can replicate.
looking under eligibility criteria,
mm-hmm.
Okay, 20% in choice program or 5% in charter schools? Are you talking charter schools enrollment district-wide?
It's a combination of both. The point is this is a choice program. This district school of innovation is a choice program. So this was part of the compromise with the House, is that you would have to have 20% of your students in some choice program, including charter, or just 5% in charter. Meaning that I believe you have that here in Pasco already. It's, you know, choice moving from school to school. You know, so if you're zoned for Mitchell, but you go to Hudson High, that's a choice. That's a choice. That's flexibility. So it's students that are no longer in the zone school that they're zoned for.
So of your overall population, 20%. Okay. Yeah. And you realize our choice is greatly inhibited by that class size amendment.
That's what the voters voted for.
That's why we turned down most choice request is because of class size.
Yeah, and then, again, this was a compromise from the House that we worked to try to get this moving.
I have a question about the full implementation of online assessments.
Mm-hmm.
What is going to be the mechanism to determine that all schools are at that point?
DOE load testing it.
Okay. And the standards and things have not yet been set?
No, but DOE will load test the schools to ensure. And this gets into the details. Right now, they have, I believe, 6 matrices that they score the school district from to see if they're. And I believe St. John's County is the only one, or Duval County, that scored 5 out of 6. So I believe that's the current mechanism that they use to load test it. They would have to, the district would have to score the maximum.
All school districts.
Yes, in order to be implemented.
Interesting.
Take a look what's happened in other states right now as they begin implementing online assessments. Yeah, it's not going well. I'm full supportive of online testing and Common Core, but also, you know, the one thing that I'm also cautious of, and I run a charter school. I love charter schools. That doesn't mean everyone should open up a charter school. You know, you need to have success. And the thing with the online assessment, I believe in the online assessment. We believe in the online assessment. It has to be done correctly. If you don't do it correctly, the whole system will collapse and it won't work. And Park right now is on its lifeline. I mean, it's almost flatlined in a lot of areas. They're trying to revive it. You know, they're looking at doing ACT and SAT comparable score for high school levels. This is to provide more opportunity for that to become successful and give it more time to kind of grow up, if you will, in that area.
Senator, back to that, and maybe it touches a little bit of what Lynn just said, but obviously I would assume that the load testing and the online assessments would only occur after this has been load tested, and that would be by district. I mean, if a district proves that it can handle the load, then we can proceed with online assessments.
I don't know the answer to that definitively yet. We haven't discussed that yet. Because no one is there yet.
My concern would be that if we're waiting for all 67 counties to be proficient, technologically speaking, then we might be looking at 2025.
Yeah, I think you have a valid point. I don't think the DOE has made an outline of it. I think right now we're so far away from that's not even an option. Again, no one is at that point, but you're right.
But it would be nice, I mean, if we knew if that were the goal, then we would know from a district perspective how much more work we had to do to get Pasco
right
to the point where we could support full implementation of online assessment. And not only that, but I think it'd be best for DOE or the state, because then you would then bring these districts on gradually and then they could build capacity as we go through. But that's a decision I'm sure they make.
Yeah, and I think, and I don't want to make it sound as though, you know, all 67 counties are so far away. But it's a majority of our rural districts are pretty far away. And a significant number of our larger districts are close, but they're not there. They're not there. I mean, even Pasco, we're just not there. You know? And it's gonna take us a few more years of better funding, of investment in technology, and hopefully the price of that technology comes down too as it goes, but that's the goal. Another bill. Is dealing with, this is, again, I'm gonna kind of plug Kurt. By the way, you school board members, if you ever have an issue, please call me or text me. Your superintendent and Ray Gadd are not shy about doing that. I'll just let you know that right now. Dealing with our colleges of education, I've been through them, and in my opinion, they're woefully inadequate. They're woefully inadequate, and they don't prepare our teachers well. What this bill does is it basically goes in and it's part of a task force implementation recommendations that all the stakeholders had and implemented various pathways and credentialing and increased our preparations and our colleges of education. My daughter just graduated from USF and I love USF, but I'll tell you what they did almost nothing for her when it comes to implementing technology in the classroom. Almost nothing. So we're going to a technological-based education, but yet our colleges of education don't teach them technology in the school.
Or the Common Core standards.
Or the Common Core standards. This bill went in there and it basically has done some major work on our colleges of education. But what it also did is there's a provision that many of us, including myself, feel dealing with our career schools. Our principles of the last decade are not the exact same principles we need for the next decade. Our schools are going to be different. You look at some of our principals, yes, they need leadership skills. Those are critical. They need curriculum skills. But quite frankly, they also need to understand industry certification skills. They also need to know how these industry field works. But if you are not from the pedagogy of the College of Education and gone through their four-year training, you're not able to become a principal and you're not useful to the districts. This creates a pathway, talking to some of your staff here, a pathway for mentor. My wife joked with me because I created a word, I call it mentorship, because it's a mentor and an internship both. It creates a three-year pathway where you can take someone, for example, in a CAPE school, and put them as an assistant principal in a CAPE school under the supervision of a principal for 3 years and basically allow them to become a principal. It's mainly designed for these new schools. These new schools that, quite frankly, our colleges of education are not preparing. And it allows a little bit more flexibility for your superintendents, who right now, by the way, could just place any principal they want anywhere into a school. This at least creates a pathway for them to identify folks, train them, and put them into a school system if they so choose, and you so choose. The last bill was a real passion of the House, and we participated in it, dealing with early learning. There was significant abuse, and I think our early learning in our state is woefully inadequate, personally, that our students are not prepared for kindergarten, and we're putting money into that system, and that we don't have very good standards. This went in and did a holistic change with our early learning coalitions, our Department of Early Learning. It created benchmarks, it created standards. As a comprehensive bill, and what it did is it created, and this was something that we had a lot of effect on, it codified in statute the School Choice Office, Office of Independent Education, because early learning is a choice program, and created in the Department of Education a Department of Independent Learning that is pre-K and School Choice Office, and also K through 12. So now there's direct governance from the Commissioner of Education on early learning. There was lots of pushback from our faith-based providers, and I don't blame them. I'm a church-going Baptist from a little kid, and we're always susceptible or skeptical of big government coming into church groups and saying, this is how you're gonna teach your kids. And I'm suspicious as well. That's why we put it in the Office of School Choice, because it's a choice office. But we do need standards. It's taxpayers' dollars going to subsidize their education, and we wanna make sure that there's quality in those programs. And that's the drive here, is to make sure there's quality. I anticipate, I can read the tea leaves and so can you. Looking at what's happening in Washington, there's probably gonna be significant dollars in the future coming out of DC dealing with early learning. And the point of this, in my view, why we work so aggressively on it, if we wanted to position Florida, if we wanted to go after those dollars, we would be in a position to go after them. If we chose not to, we don't have to, but at least we're at least in that position to go after it if we want to. So that is a high level overview of probably issues that you have not read about at all in the press. Not because they're not doing their job, but it's not sexy issues. They're real meat and potato issues. It's not parent trigger. I always joke with parent trigger, as you know, it died. Right now, parents have 5 choices and the school board decides. And if parent trigger passed, we would have 5 choices and the school board would have decided. So it was much ado about nothing, but yet it took all the political wind out of Tallahassee. You know, and so we're in the same position whether it passed or failed. So, but these are good policies.
Well, I just want to applaud you on the public childhood education. You and I talked about it years ago in DOE, but I think the way that you've done it will keep it from becoming overly bureaucratic.
Yeah. A lot of good bills. I mean, there was a lot, you know, Tallahassee Democrat said this was the education renaissance year when they started looking at all the policies and the funding that we put in there. That was the phrase they called this year for education.
One quick question, because it's based on something I heard on the radio driving over here talking about.
That's dangerous.
I know, that's why I want clarification on it, because that's always dangerous, because they never get it right. They were saying.
Except the safety times, of course.
And the trip.
They were saying $1 million extra towards education, then plus the 480 towards teacher raises. But I was kind of understanding the 480 is in the 1 million.
The billion, 480 is in the billion.
Yeah, that's what the billion.
A total, I mean, that's, I think.
That's what I thought, so I just.
Pasco received about 6.5% increase overall in the FEFP, I believe it was. When you back out the teacher mandated bonuses, it's about a 2.5% increase.
Yeah, okay.
So, I mean, it's still an increase, you know, but about 3.5% of that is earmarked for teacher raises.
Yeah, that's what I thought. The radio thing just confused me.
Senator, just to touch on one thing, which is in the bill 1664 about the expectations of performance evaluations for teachers based on academic performance of students directly instructed.
Oh, yes.
You know, we've been struggling with that here and across the state, so I just. I'd like to hear you talk a little bit about that.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because that's probably one of the biggest things we passed this year that no one talks about. One of the most challenging aspects of 736 is, you know, you as the board have that decision to create new ones, but please, I know it's hard to create them. I mean, it's not a disparaging remark. Those students that do not have a statewide end-of-course assessment or end-of-course exam, you could look at the school average and attribute that to that teacher. First grade teacher, for example. What there was significant pushback and significant consternation of, how does that work? You know, here I'm a teacher and I'm being judged on students I never taught. That doesn't seem equitable. I don't use the word fair, because a fair is a traveling circus, I've learned. But it doesn't seem equitable. So what this bill did, which we worked really hard on, it is basically said, you cannot evaluate a teacher unless they actually taught that student. So the teacher evaluation has to actually be linked on that student. We also gave districts significant, we basically told, in my views, why is the DOE involved in your job when it comes to teacher evaluation? That's what you guys do best. So what we said is, when it comes to the front half of the 50% of the professional evaluation, DOE, you shouldn't care what they do. Let the districts decide. Have a couple benchmarks, multiple evaluations, and that's it. But let the school districts determine the front 50%. Let statewide assessments or end-of-course exams developed by the districts do the back 50%. If there are no back 50%, that's fine. There's no implementation date. They just cannot be part of any performance funding going forward in the future until you as a district develop that end of course exam for that course. So your art teacher who does not have an end of course exam, if you don't want to develop one, that's fine. They won't be part of that evaluation model. You'll have to use professional model that you want, but they won't be eligible for performance dollars going forward until you develop that end of course exam. That's the incentive for you as a district to create an end of course exam in all areas, but it doesn't have that drop dead date of next year.
It seems like a catch-22 though, because the end of course exams are so expensive for districts to implement. It's like we're in this catch-22. If we don't implement them, we don't get the future dollars, but we don't have the dollars to put toward the research and development of the end of course exams.
Well, I don't know if I agree with you on that. Seems that the goal is on those, because the state does not approve them, the end of course exams, the non-statewide assessments. And Hillsboro, Duval, and I believe one other county pretty much has them all already, where you could basically use their assessments, and that would satisfy the state's requirement.
In one of the school board association meetings I sent, and that was part of the discussion, was trying to work within the districts cooperatively to come up with something to save money, and they said that some of them already had models for most of the courses.
Yeah. Hillsboro, I believe, has the most.
Or communicate with, as he was on the Senate floor, I'm sure that the deal will now be is to make sure that the governor keeps things in the budget. it doesn't strike the veto pen for some things, but I think that this has been a great year for Pasco County. Certainly, there's still a lot of work to be done, but I think Senator Legg gives a lot of credit for where you are, along with the rest of the Pasco delegation. Pasco fared very well.
Well, I will say, you know, you had Speaker Weatherford in the House. You know, we're young, but we're not that young, and one of the things that, you know, Will and I and Wilton, which is my seat partner, we realized that early on that when the Speaker asks for something from the House going to the Senate, it becomes trade bait. You know, it becomes, okay, well, that's important to the Speaker, so we're going to want something in exchange. But if the Senate asks for it, it doesn't become as important to the House, and all the House has to do is accept it. And so what we, Wilt and I, were able to do is we were able to put in a lot of money in the budget for Pasco, for education, for CAPE, for initiatives. You know, $1.5 million for a STEM program for Pasco, which I think, you know, if I can implore you as a board member, as a private citizen, we desperately, desperately need it at the high school level. And we'll be back again trying to get you more money next year. Because when I went to Hillsborough and those other counties, that is something that I think our county is crying out for, and whatever I can do to help in that regards, I know I can speak for Will and say we will do whatever we can to make sure that funding is there to be there for you. So
I'd also like to add real quickly that I don't know how often Superintendent Brown would call me, but I must have called him 100 times and was never exasperated or frustrated, almost always called me back. And then it was even worse because if I couldn't get hold of him, Eric Prutzman went over there and stood in front of his door. And he never showed any aggravation or distress about us contacting him. So we appreciate it.
Well, thank you for all you do. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you, John. And over the years, you've been wonderful with education. So we really appreciate it. And hopefully you can stay around.